Hello everyone and welcome to the test of the Reliant Space Shuttle. I've decided to update my Space Shuttle design, my Real Solar System Realism Overhaul Space Shuttle design from 0.23 and 0.23.5 to create this new shuttle, mainly because of both procedural parts and the new B9 parts. And so of course with the new B9 parts we got this nifty little cockpit. So I decided it was time to create a new Space Shuttle to take advantage of these parts, and it looks great. Now, this space shuttle has similarities and differences from the real one, and I'm going to go through that now here in the VAB. Of course, the looks are pretty darn spot on, if I do say so myself. The engines are correct as far as the RS-25Ds there, and go away. This one, Aerojet AJ-10-190, is in fact the OMS engines. You can see I've put the RCS on the little RCS extension. I guess I'll call them arms. The aero brakes, I've added aero brakes here. That's why this is B. I'm not entirely sure I need them or want them. They're just in case, okay? But they're probably not going to do very much. The cockpit was an interesting thing. The mass of the cockpit is quite heavy. It's 7 tons, actually. And I had to get it to work with real fuels. And so I had to do some tweaking on that. So this is a tweaked cockpit to make sure it uses MMH N204, and it doesn't actually. It has MMH N204, but the RCS system in the cockpit doesn't actually work, which is why I have these RCS pods up here, because that's the only way I can put them there in order to make sure that they don't burn up on re-entry. Which is a big point of clarification. I have tested this. This has gone through 20 tests so far. It took about 3 tests to make sure I could get it into orbit, and then another 17 tests where I was trying to land it at Cape Canaveral. And I still haven't done that yet, but I'm recording this because I'm reasonably close, and well, if we fail, we fail, and if we succeed, I want it to be recorded, obviously. And but once I press the record button, it goes up on YouTube, so that's the situation. We're going to find out. I've got VNG parachutes installed. I hate it when the wing disappears. Anyway, I've got VNG parachutes installed so we can have the crew bail out if we get to low altitude but we can't quite hit Cape Canaveral. The external tank is pretty much spot on. You know, I put the liquid oxygen right up top like the real external tank has. We've got some liquid oxygen in here, and I'm gonna have to pump that up at one point during the flight so that the whole thing keeps its balance. The liquid oxygen, of course, is much heavier than the liquid hydrogen, and we want the center of mass. Oh, I should put those up. We want the center of mass as high as possible, and so doing that, pumping the liquid oxygen up, will make sure that the center of mass remains high. You can see where the center of thrust is when the solid boosters are there. Of course, you can see the tilt to the engines on the SSMEs. Oh, that's another change I had to make. You can't do this with Realism Overhaul now, but you used to be able to. And what it was Realism Overhaul used to use real engines in order to modify the attachment system. But it turns out that that's really only helpful for the special case of the space shuttle. Otherwise, it causes other problems, as I understand it, reading the Realism Overhaul thread. So they decided not to have that sort of attachment point modification. And of course, now you can cluster engines using the procedural fairings thrust plate. So it's not quite as necessary as it used to be. But I had to restore the old version of the attachment points in order to get the engines to attach like this. So that's how they are like that. It might be hard to duplicate that if you don't have a copy of the old Realism Overhaul or the old real engines. Okay. Another difference between this and the other shuttle is that I think I've got the 5 segment boosters on. It only said ATK reusable rockets. My problem was it seems like every one of them is a 5-segment one. So I picked, is it this one? Yeah, I think it's this one that I picked. The largest, most powerful solid boosters ever used to launch a vehicle into space, I think maybe that this is a 5-segment one. But then I've got this ATK 5-segment Space Shuttle SRB too. It seems like the only ones I have are 5-segment ones. So if no, but this one has more thrust. This one's heavier and has more thrust. So this must be the 4-segment one. The reason I think it's the 5-segment one is because it lasts longer than it should. The real Space Shuttle SRBs should burn out quicker than this does. And that might be just a matter of the thrust curve being wrong, which is possible. So yeah, I guess these are the right ones, because they are lighter in mass. This is only 569 tons, and this is 733 tons. This one has much more thrust. Yeah, okay. So I actually got that right. I thought that was a difference. You'll notice all the little separation boosters. You'll see how that works out. That took some fiddling with that. Well, really only 3 flights to get that right. And yeah, otherwise, this gets into space a little bit faster than the real space shuttle. I think my shuttle is a little bit lighter. You can see it's 52.8 tons. But that's already, it's got payload. Well, of a sort. I mean, it's got a hitchhiker can with the docking port on top, and it's also got this mobile processing lab. So it's not completely empty here. And I probably wouldn't fly it completely empty. Now my intention with this, I mean, you'll see I've got a lot of parts going on here. For instance, even though it's not a part of the shuttle, I've put KES, I've put Infernal Robotics. And if this works out, I would like to try and use it as something in a series. This is version 0.24.264-bit, by the way, I should mention that. So this is not as updated as everybody else might have. That's important. And, well, yeah, I think all the best parts are spoken for. Oh, the RCS pods do have the MMHN-204, but I'm carrying much more fuel than the normal space shuttle would in the shuttle itself. So we've got 1,237 delta V, and that's because I'm not as good as doing orbital maneuvers as NASA is. Okay. So, and besides, the structure of the shuttle seems to be lighter than it normally would be. And that causes a problem, by the way, because the cockpit is 7 tons, a very heavy cockpit, which means that the center mass tends forward a lot more than it would on the real space shuttle. And so I needed the extra fuel in the back to counterbalance that. Now, in the real space shuttle, they used to put ballast in the back in order to keep the balance. In fact, one of the space shuttle designers commented that he really didn't like the idea, like to think about how many tons of completely useless stuff they carried into orbit, because they just had to get the center mass right. So yeah, interesting food for thought. Alright, with that, I think we will take it out to the launch pad. This is a fresh save I imported the craft into, so we should have our normal 3 guys up. So even though the real initial space shuttle flight had 2 pilots, well, not 2 pilots, 1 commander and 1 pilot, we are going to take 3. Alright, so yep, I think that's good enough. Let's get out to the launch pad. Okay, so here we are at Cape Canaveral, and you'll have to forgive the lack of really elaborate launch clamp placements, because or launch towers, because frankly we don't have enough space on the pad. Things will be flopping all over the place, I think. So I had to be spare about it. We are using the Saturn V launch clamps from the FASA pack, and of course these are also from the FASA pack. And yeah, we can engage SAS, throttle up. The cockpit view is really great. If I do eventually end up being able to do missions in this, it would be nice to sort of have this going. You know, we've got all sorts of stuff here, like vessel view, or one thing that is a problem, and you notice the red blinking lights, is that it only measures fuel oxidizer and monopropellant. It doesn't understand real fuels. I think the RAS prop monitor by default understands real fuels, but this is the B9 adjustment to RAS prop monitor, I think, so not quite the same. So we've got all sorts of stuff here, like engine igniter and all that. So that will be neat. But for now, and of course it's real neat to see the VAB off to the side there. But yep, this one I especially like. But we're not gonna do it from that view this time, because this is our first look at this and we want to see it launched properly. Okay, so yep, the guys look all ready. I time warped to daylight, so we have had a little bit of hydrogen boil off, and that's why that's like that. But that's not a problem. We've got plenty of delta V to spare. We're carrying a relatively light payload for this particular system. We can carry much heavier stuff. Okay, I think that's all good to go. One thing I should mention even before I start off is that in the payload bay in the back there, there is one of the rather overpowered B9 SAS, the torque wheels, the reaction wheels. And that is not for launch so much as it is for landing. That's for re-entry, because I can't keep the nose up with this if I want to re-enter. Now, it was if I reconfigure this so it looked nothing like the space shuttle, I could probably figure out how to get it to re-enter without having a reaction wheel like that. But if it was a case of either I wanted to look like the space shuttle or I made it re-enter properly without the reaction wheel, I couldn't figure out how to do both yet. If I eventually do, I would be glad to get rid of the reaction wheel. One thing, and so the testing for launches and to get into orbit was done without the reaction wheel. So if you would like to, you can pay attention to the pitch, for instance, to see. But really, it's because of the engine gimbling. I don't need the reaction wheel there because the engines gimbal so much that I can keep it stable. In fact, I will be flying it manually. I won't be using Smart ESS to fly because Smart ESS can't deal with the engine gimbling. So it'll be just me and SAS handling this one. Okay, I wouldn't say it isn't able to handle it, but it gimbals them too much, which is inefficient. All right, so here we go. We are ready to go. I'm not gonna do a countdown. Let's just go for it. All right, main engine ignition. Okay, wait for stability. Gimbling is okay. Looks like we're good to go, and launch. I am not touching the controls right now, and that's because I made sure that that launch clamp that clamps onto the external tank was at exactly the right height so that the external tank would clear it. There we go. Okay, so now I'm going to take control and begin the roll program. And the pitch program. This thing has a huge thrust to weight ratio, so pitch program pretty quick. Much quicker than I would with a vehicle that had a thrust weight ratio of 1.2, which is what I normally build. And one of the other effects of having high thrust weight ratio, of course, is that you can get to orbit with much less delta V. So with a thrust weight ratio of 1.2, I get into orbit with 9,500 meters per second, but this can get into orbit with more like 9,300, maybe even less than that, but about 9,300. Altogether, the amount of delta V with the sonic rocket boosters and external tank is about 9,900. Looking good. Now this is max Q here, and the real shuttle throttled down during max Q to reduce stress, and we'll be able to see flight data. Okay, dynamic pressure still going up, and right around here, just as it's passing Mach 1, the dynamic pressure goes down, but we'll wait a little bit before throttling up here. Nice day. I like having clouds out to give a sense of motion here. Okay, I think we'll go for throttle up here. One thing I was worried about, because of an experience in my Realism Overhaul series, was whether the procedural parts were actually experiencing drag. But one thing you'll notice as we get higher is that we'll see that they heat up properly. And that I take as a sign that they are experiencing drag properly. So we'll get to about 30 kilometers and I'll check the heat there. Right now they're probably moderate. Well, no, they're heating up already. 200, and you'll see that this is not a procedural part, it is a V9 cockpit, and it's heating up the same way. So I think that's a good indication that this is actually experiencing proper drag. I hope. In any case, we do use the correct amount of delta V to get into orbit, so no problem there. I already talked about the SRBs. In the VAB, you saw that the SRBs seem to have a time of mid and 30 seconds. That's not true. MechJeb actually was thinking that the SRBs had constant thrust. They don't. They actually have variable thrust. It depends on where they are in their cycle, and overall they diminish over time. We're gonna wait, and of course if you try and wait until they're completely out, it's hopeless. You'll be carrying them all the way to orbit. We'll wait until they're down to 400 kilonewtons, which was, I believe, where the space shuttle released them, and that's where I'll release them as well. Right here, this is our pitch for separation, so we're just gonna keep like this for the rest of the way until I separate the SRBs. You'll see things are heating up, but not too badly. I might as well bring up FAR just so you can see, just in case you guys see something anomalous, you can tell me. So just waiting for booster separation here. We are higher than we should be. You'll notice acceleration is not going up very fast now. That's because the boosters, even though we're getting lighter because of all the burning of the hydrogen and oxygen, now the mass of the boosters is overwhelming the amount of thrust they're providing. But if we try to release them now, they would still rocket forward because they're no longer carrying the rest of the vehicle. So we can't release them until they're at about 400 kilonewtons. So let's take it flat on like this so we can see. Alright, we're good to go. Ah, now isn't that beautiful? And you might have noticed that the pitch didn't change very much during all that. Still quite stable. However, it is going to change if I don't pump some of the liquid oxygen up. So I'm going to do that now. I'm going to pump liquid oxygen up until this gets to level. Okay, we'll adjust more later. Really, I need another liquid oxygen tank here instead of having both liquid and liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen in here. But I did not think of that in time before I finished my launch testing. So I've got this system. Now we have a little bit of a problem because this thing does not like to stay stable in roll and yaw. I don't know why, because it's pretty much spot on in terms of where it is. It might be the engine placement, because I have to put the SSMEs individually in order to get them tilted properly. That I couldn't use symmetry on the engine, so maybe they're slightly asymmetrical somehow. And that's causing this need for a bit of a roll here. But it's very disconcerting. Now, I'm going to use... There are two possible flight profiles. There's one where I aim for apoapsis on this side of the planet, and the periapsis on the opposite side. And in that case, the external tank would end up re-entering on the opposite side of the planet. And we would probably need two OMS burns. I'm going to use the one OMS burn version, which is we're going to be getting to low periapsis on this side, around 100 kilometers. And we're going to have the apoapsis on the opposite side of the planet. And in that way, the external tank will end up re-entering on this side of the planet. And we are only going to have one OMS burn, which we'll do at apoapsis as we coast up to that. So that's the one I'm going to do. And I guess the space shuttle would have used one or the other depending on which inclination they were launching at, maybe. Because they'll want the external tank to drop at a certain location. They want to control where the external tank drops and not just have it drop on a populated place. It's not intact when it drops. You'll have heard it burns up in the atmosphere. It doesn't burn up completely in the atmosphere. It disintegrates in the atmosphere, and then there are fragments that end up dropping into the ocean. And so it's those fragments that they'd be worried where they end up. Now, of course, the tank is mostly innocuous. The fuel itself is liquid hydrogen, liquid oxygen. It'll just dissipate in the atmosphere immediately. The construction materials are not, I don't believe, were particularly hazardous, though some of it, because they're storing cryogenics, might have been a little bit dubious. But on the whole, maybe the, well, I don't know exactly the composition of what went on there, but they certainly were concerned about where the bits of the external tank ended up. So, but anyway, I'm going to do that. Okay, the roll is getting a little bit... See, the problem is if I try to correct the roll, the yaw starts getting a little bit iffy. You can see they're sort of coupled somehow. I'm going to try and bring this flattish. Oh, I need RCS. Jeez, what am I doing? Control surfaces, obvious. I mean, of course, the engine gimbling is doing most of the work, but there are certain axes that the engine gimbling isn't going to help us out with. And so RCS is necessary for that. Okay, looks like we're okay here, though it's going to end up rolling a bit. That happened during testing. Don't know why that happens. Or, in this case, it's actually yawing a bit. Now, you'll see that the thrust is actually not level with the horizon, so we're not actually at zero pitch or anything like that yet. We would actually have to tilt down negative 10 on the nav ball in order to actually be zero pitch. You'll see that the center mass is around here right now, and speaking of which, our pitch is getting a little bit... So let's pump the rest of the liquid oxygen up. Basically, the center mass is around here, and the thrust is going like that. And that's the actual angle, that's actual pitch angle that we're talking about here. So we're eventually going to nose down to negative 10 to actually have it level. And we should probably do that now, kind of think of it. Our time to apoapsis is getting a little bit excessive. Uh-oh. The yaw and roll is getting me. We're actually a little bit high right now. I would not have wanted this side to be 125 kilometers. I'd want it more like 100. I think they actually, if they did this flight profile, they probably had it even lower than that, perhaps. I think, what was it, 60 nautical miles or something like that? That seems to be a number I remember. Okay, I think we can throttle down now. Our G-forces are getting up there. Okay, here we go. I'm aiming for about 380 kilometers. And that's where I did my re-entry tests. Okay, that's good. All right, so now all is well. Everything checks out. Mission control says go for SEP and ET SEP now. Okay, I'm using RSS to thrust forward a little bit, but we're not gonna burn the OMS engines here. I guess we could do it. Let's do a token OMS burn to clear the external tank, shall we? Now you see the awesome thrust of the OMS engines. Note 577 millimeters per second of acceleration. These guys, they're 26.7 kilonewtons, these Aerojet AJ10s. Cute little engines. Take a whole lot of time to burn, though. Very reliable, of course. But they try their best. Every component of the space shuttle, they try their best to get the mass down. Okay, we're actually boosting that apoapsis way too high. Sorry. And I'll use RCS to correct that. Okay, here we are approaching the OMS burn point. Obviously, apoapsis, we're 2 minutes away from that, but we need to flip around. Gotta take SAS off. The most efficient way to flip around, of course, is to do a RCS burn and just let it go. So I'm just gonna let it drift around. You can see that I've put some external lights on the shuttle. I don't believe they had them. I've got two embedded in the vertical stabilizer there, and I've also got some in the forward nose of the OMS pods. Okay, the OMS engines are either on or off. There's no throttling on them, so it doesn't matter what the throttle setting is. And in my testing, I found that it doesn't really take too long for them to boost. Certainly, this is a very high periapsis to boost it up to the level we wanted at. Really, the periapsis should be negative, if possible. But I mean, that's only for the double OMS burn version, though. It would have to be. I'd have to look up the number for the single OMS burn version. Gotta get this back to prograde. I hesitate to use Smart ASS, but maybe just for this time. There we go. I'm afraid that Smart ASS might overuse the torque instead of the RCS. I actually wanted to use the RCS because we don't want to be particularly heavy coming down. We want to be heavy enough so that it counterbalances it makes sure that the center mass is behind everything else. But otherwise, a light landing would be nice. Okay, our apoapsis seems to be going up. Okay, I'm not gonna push it more than that. I think that's good enough. I could probably circularize. Well, okay, fine. No. Okay, that's as close as it gets. So yeah, 400 by 395 I think is sufficient. And on the nighttime side, I believe the space shuttle was actually. Oh, I need to turn off gimbling on the engines. That's gonna be very annoying otherwise. Okay, yep, cargo bay open. Okay, there we go. Cargo bay is open. Everybody's ready for business. We could transfer guys into the stuff, but we don't really need to. This is sort of a test of this is as much as the shuttle is going to be able to carry back to the ground forward. Now, it could carry a heavier payload back to the ground if that payload is attached to the back of the vessel because center mass again. But as far as having a payload forward, this is as much as it can do. At least that was my theory when testing it. So that's what I'm going with here. Okay, now the tough part, bring it back down again, which I have probably less than a 50-50 chance of doing. I have never hit the runway at Cape Canaveral. Let's just be clear about that. I've done more than 20 tests, and I've never actually hit Cape Canaveral, which is right there. Now, obviously our orbit is going to be precessing with every with respect to the surface. So what we're gonna do is the simplest thing, which is to just wait a day, right? We wait a day. After a day, the orbital precession will reset at this orbit. And yep, that's what I'm gonna go for. It'll be more complicated with higher inclinations, I think, because it depends on what the period of your orbit is. But I think it'll be alright. Of course, there is the shuttle's infamous cross-range ability, and during testing, I can't seem to make much use of that. Honestly, I could probably deviate it by 100 or 200 miles, but nothing like the 2,000 that they said that it was able to do. So I haven't figured that one out yet. Okay, but I really don't want to bother with that, because that makes landing a whole lot harder. You'll notice I have the trajectory mod here, and that isn't as reliable as I would like on this case. We'll see about that once we get to that point. But I'll catch up with you once we've been in orbit for a day, well, a little bit less than a day, and then we'll talk about re-entry. Okay, here we are on our final orbit for the tests. You can see that the orbit is now at a decent position. You can see Florida right there. So I'm gonna stop time warp here. We're going to retro burn at 104, 200, I guess. Should do it at, I've got a lot of data here. I've actually got my laptop on with a whole spreadsheet worth of data for all of my re-entry tests. And I think I'm gonna go for 104 degrees east as my retro burn point. That's approximately on the opposite side of the planet from Cape Canaveral. Technically 100 degrees east will be directly opposite. Yes, 100 degrees east will be directly opposite Cape Canaveral. 104 is just based on my testing, that's all. So yeah, we're pretty much doing an optimal retro burn. But here we go. We're going to time warp to the retro burn point. Which will be on the dark side, because one benefit of delaying re-entry for a day, aside from having your orbit in the right place, is also that if you launched in daylight, you're going to land in daylight. So definite plus on that one. Gotta close the cargo bay now. Gotta keep the cargo bay open while it's in orbit, by the way. If they for some reason can't get the cargo bay open, they need to actually come back down right away, because the whole system will overheat. The cargo bay allows the heat to radiate out. Another reason why it's not facing the sun, it wants to radiate the heat away. And if they can't open it, they can't radiate the heat away. But now that we are on our last orbit, we can close it up, and that will be safe. Now we are going to take a peek at what the trajectory mod might actually say about how things work out and compare it to what actually happens. What I'm not going to do is use any of these descent profile things, because if anything, they seem to make things worse in terms of the prediction. So, but I'll show all that. Okay, getting ready, and here we go. Okay, a whole 0.6 meters per second squared of acceleration. But that's enough. Sort of cute how the space shuttle uses these little guys to deorbit. They are, of course, tilted that way in order so that their thrust goes through the center of mass of the vehicle. I don't believe they gimbal, by the way. I forget if they do or not. Doesn't have a gimbling option here, so I don't think they do. The orientation is maintained by RSS. Oh, I forgot to mention, I do, for the look of things, have some residual hydrogen and oxygen. Now, that's meant to be residual in the engine. There is a little bit of leftover. I don't think it burns it all cleanly. I forget if it I don't think it does. So I do simulate a little bit of residual hydrogen and oxygen in the engine area. That just happened. I wasn't thinking about doing that ahead of time, but it ended up being that it was convenient to do so. So I just went ahead with it. Okay, trajectory should detect, yes, that we have some interaction with the atmosphere. Keep in mind that the world will rotate as we go along. It'll rotate about... one of the reasons I burn at 104 degrees east instead of just 100 is that the planet will rotate about 10 degrees by the time we get there. Okay, now it's iffy on the trajectory, that's why it's giving this warning. It's not entirely sure what's going on because we're right at the cusp of either skipping out or coming back down. Now I calculated 65. Now trajectory said I'm gonna end up over here. Even though I think it should be about 65-ish. Now I'm pretty high, so I need to come down a little bit lower. I tested at about 380 kilometers. So perhaps, still don't think it should be that low. I think I would fall short if I tried to come in any lower than this in order to bring this X over here. It gets worse if I, now my descent profile on entry angle of attack is going to be 40. And it thinks if I have a 40 degree angle of attack, I'm not even going to barely come into the atmosphere. It's going to... That won't have me in the atmosphere. Here, I'm going to land out here. But that will be my angle of attack. But the thing is, it assumes that a high angle of attack only results in lift. The space shuttle, when it has a high angle of attack, also generates a huge amount of drag. And this doesn't seem to take that into account. In fact, with its high angle of attack, the space shuttle will actually pull this in, not push it out. And so it's not really, especially if it's at higher than 40 degrees. If it's at lower than 40 degrees, it will tend to push it out further out. And that's part of the way you control it, though you don't have too much leeway. The real space shuttle, the limit is like 35 degrees. That's the lowest they can go with not burning up. This shuttle is going to be able to go lower than that. I think I'm going to adjust this to 64 kilometers. And I'm probably going to regret it. Again, this stuff is really tricky to try and figure out exactly how you want to re-enter this. But I'm going to go with 64 and we'll see what happens. At this point, I'm going to compare with the trajectory data from my previous flights and try and make some adjustments based on that, but still, yeah, 400 kilometers is actually a bit high compared to what I did those test flights at, so it's going to be interesting. Anyway, trajectory says I'm going to end up way over there. We might. That might be true. Now I'm going to turn Smart ESS off, and I'm going to manually bring this around. But I don't need it directly prograde. We're going to end up wanting it a little bit, maybe around there, and point it down a bit. Because I've got time warp to about 200 kilometers and then start comparing my trajectory with my data. Okay, that'll be fine. Now we can time warp. Are we stable? Alright, SAS now. Okay, 200 kilometers we're going to. And I want to see around 160 degrees west on that. Okay, I think we are going long. So trajectories was actually right compared to that. So long, but that's based on a 65 kilometer periapsis. So we're long for a 65, but we are actually aimed at a 64. But just to be safe, I'm going to keep the angle up, and I'm gonna say our heading. I'm gonna pull up far now because we need this data here. I'm gonna say 62 heading, and I'm gonna have pitch 45, and that will increase our drag once we hit the atmosphere. 155 is doable at this point, so I don't have to like abort the re-entry or anything like that. Okay, 160 we're coming up on. Let me get this. Smart ASS can handle it. It's gonna bring us back down to where I want it to be, and I'm gonna say 65 heading. When we hit Cape Canaveral, we should be at a 90-degree heading, assuming we did everything correctly. Nominal trajectory would have us at 147 at 160 kilometers, and we are further along than that. So again, probably need to expect. Let's keep it a 45-ish. Possibly more than that, but I'll keep it to that for now. Right when you hit the atmosphere, basically your opportunity to fix things is between 80 kilometers and 133 kilometers. And I really wish the atmosphere would extend higher than 133 kilometers because then I'd be able to fix things right now. But there is no lift or drag right now, even though in real life there would be. So it's not giving me much opportunity to fix things. Let's see what trajectory says right now. Trajectory has pulled it in a bit, I think. But anyway, if we actually programmed in our current angle of attack, we'd be way off. But here, it still seems we're going pretty far out there. We might end up doing that. Let's see. Nominal trajectory is 140 at 140 kilometers, so we are way ahead of that. I'm going to 48 degrees. We still haven't hit the atmosphere yet. We should be getting some lift and drag here by now. Oh, there we go. Phew. Had me worried there. We're already past the nominal for 120 kilometers. At 100 kilometers, I'd like to see 123 degrees west. But we're gonna be overshooting that, I think. I should mention that the heat shielding is a reflective heat shielding of 0.25, which is default for B9. I added it to the procedural wings as well. So it's 0.25, which seems to be what B9 has. Still going very long. Whoa, 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 whoa. This looks like side slip. Okay. Let's decrease. Oop, not like that. It's the physical time warp is messing things up here. Keep it steady here. Of course, we could do S turns here right now. We could dissipate the extra energy by actually doing pretty close to what it's actually doing here. Let's go to 85 instead. Guess it's a good time to take temperature readings. Negative 37 in the cockpit, and probably about the same on the control surfaces. Those are the key points. Maybe the landing gear on the nose gear, but otherwise, those are the points that you expect to have some heating. The wings are a little bit complicated because they've got not just if it was just the leading edge, then we'd have a pretty clear situation. But the temperature reading is sort of, I guess, evened out across the surface, and so there's also the temperature on the bottom of it or the back of it, which isn't quite the same. I don't know how it works with the temperature on the wings. The control surfaces are a little bit more discrete. Okay, it looks like we're 6 degrees too far east. We're down to 40-degree pitch. You can see it's having trouble keeping high pitch, even with the big reaction wheel in the back there. And the RCS going as well as it can. I'm not doing S-turns or any sort of way to dissipate further because we can barely hold our attitude as it is, and also I want to test the numbers. So let's see if we can bring it in anyway. Again, the guys have VNG parachutes, so if we have to have them bail out in the Atlantic, that's something we can do. Things heating up there, 140, 150 degrees Celsius now. According to what I heard, this little body flap is obviously it's meant to shield the engines, but they used it for trim. And obviously it's not very effective at this height. Right now it's all RCS and the torque. And of course aerodynamic effects. Once you start out at an angle, the fact that the atmosphere is hitting it sort of has an effect too. So this thing can manage to re-enter at a lower pitch angle than the space shuttle can. And that's not by intention, that's because I don't have enough torque to lift the nose higher. I would love to be able to keep the thing at 40 degrees all the way and just run the numbers like that. But I think that would take yet another one of the obscenely powerful B9 aerospace reaction wheels. And I think I don't want to go there, so I would rather try and fix this as much as possible without that. Could add more RCS. You might think that it'd be trivial just to add another one a little bit forward here, but actually that would heat up and burn up and die. So that's why those are here. It can't go any further back because this is the cargo bay doors. So this is as far back as it can go and still be effective. Okay, the cockpit is at 350 degrees Celsius. Control surfaces 370. I checked these because these are the things that will overheat first, actually. Heating in this is not exactly the way you think it might work. And the landing gear, you can see, is for reasons unknown to me, cooler than the cockpit. And that's probably because of the heat right here. It's not really the heat of the whole thing. The way it's calculated, I can't tell at what point the heating is actually being calculated. It's basically the point. You can sort of see how much of the fuel we're burning off just by holding attitude during re-entry. One thing I can do is send some of the fuel further back. Don't know if that helps or not, but maybe it does. We're still about... No, we're short now, are we? Hold on. No, we're about 2 degrees long. That's fine. Okay, so 2 degrees long right now. Okay, so here we go. That's Florida in front of us. And now Trajectories thinks that we're gonna land here, which is also wrong. But now I think if we actually added the entry profile to it, they'll be a little bit closer to truth. But yeah, it's just way off when you're talking about trying to re-enter this thing and you're trying to plan it ahead of time. Heat, 735. 800 on the control surfaces. You can see our velocity going down seriously now. G-forces are mild though, and they are for the shuttle. The shuttle does not experience high G-loads during re-entry. The area of maximum heating is around 50 kilometers. We're still going up right now. things get dicey beyond 1,000 degrees Celsius. But probably critical around 1,200. Especially on the control surfaces in the back. Okay, here we go, around maximum heating. Still going up, 851. We can start maneuvering as, well, we could even be maneuvering right now, but we can start maneuvering as early as 35 kilometers in altitude. We could try turning now, but it won't have too much effect. Temperature's going down. I don't think it got too far beyond 900. There you can see, those are probably our launch clamps. We're about 92 kilometers away from them. Gonna take Smart ASS off and take control now. And I'm gonna start turning. We can continue to monitor the temperature to make sure it doesn't go all wild or anything. Very important to do so. You can see it's going up now because of the turn. This shuttle was, I tested the aerodynamics first. I slapped jet engines on it and tried it out. So it's pretty aerodynamically okay. Still falls like a brick though. Earlier on, large-scale stalling didn't matter because we were just barely hitting the atmosphere, but now I have to pay attention to that. And in fact, let's keep it closer to the prograde vector. You can see our speed is going down though, and that's gonna be the thing. We're gonna lose velocity, and that's gonna make it hard for us to get back home. We're gonna end up way off. I can't turn this quickly enough to get us back. Okay, we're approximately 66,000 feet for those who are more comfortable with those sorts of numbers. Mach 2.2. Once we get around, I will attempt to use the OMS engines to, even though you're not supposed to, but it's better than crashing into, we'll probably end up still crashing into the water. But I'll try to use that. So initially, we've been going too far off all the whole time. So probably need to pull it in, but not as much as the trajectory mod would have had me believe. I'm pretty sure I would have burned up if I tried to deorbit to the periapsis that it was recommending. Well, not recommending, but it was indicating that would be necessary to hit the Cape at. I never actually bothered with the air brakes. I probably should have used them. Might have been able to hit the Cape like that. Really, they're actually there because I need to slow down on touchdown. This thing ends up touching down very fast and doesn't have much by way of brakes. Okay, well, we're gonna see how close we get here. And alright, I guess I might as well run the engines. That's the Cape way over there. Even with the OMS engines on, you can see we're still losing velocity. Jeb's excited. I'll have the guys bail out at about 5,000 meters. There's no way we're making it back to land. By the way, the astronauts technically could bail out, especially after the Challenger accident. They had you'll notice what's going to happen is these Kerbals are going to bump into the shuttle quite a lot. But what the real shuttle pilots had was they had a slide going down. And so they'd extend the slide, and that would make sure that they were sort of thrown away from the shuttle itself. Still seems like we're more than 100 miles away from the Cape, otherwise we'd see the debris. Pretty bad. Got a long way to go with this thing. A lot more testing. Still, you can see the glide slope is okay. I mean, we would be able to bring it down. You can see the vertical speed diminishing. If the runway was just a little bit closer, we'd be on a good path here. Actually, we would nose down quite a bit more. Okay, I'm shutting down the engines, and we're gonna start having these guys bail out. Bill will have to go first. Yep, knock into the thing. Okay, Bill, semi-deploy parachute. Okay, fully deploy parachute, please. Because I don't have enough time otherwise. Okay, back to the shuttle. Okay, Bob out next. Okay, yeah. Bob, can you sort of scoot off to the side before? Oh, no, it doesn't look like it. Okay, Bob, just semi. Ouch, 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 ouch. Okay, why did they put the hatch on the top like that? Yeah, that's a weird way to go. Yeah, I really don't approve of the hatch being on the top. In the real shuttle, they were afraid of knocking into the wing. No sign of the debris over there yet. I don't know why this happens. Of course, this is 0.24, remember, so a lot of stuff probably has been fixed. Okay, Jeb, I think you really need to bail out now. Huh, Jeb sort of ends up sitting. This sort of reminds me of Dr. Strangelove, you know, riding the nuke down. That's hilarious. Can you scoot off this? Oh, okay, very ragdoll. Okay, Jeb, I think we should semi-deploy your parachute here. Up, you missed the rudder. Good. Vertical stabilizer, I mean. Okay, well, the shuttle rewind is going off. We'll just follow Jeb down. Well, we know what happens with the shuttle. Let's just make sure that the VNG parachutes treats our Kerbals right. I wouldn't say it's particularly treating them right now, like this, but hey, could be worse, I suppose. Can you move around? Oh, yes, you can. Okay, good. Well, that's a little bit better. That does not look like our data. So, we ended up here. We're about 700 meters. I don't know why my GUI is gone. I want to recover him. Oop. Missed splashdown. Seems to be floating fine. Okay, so that worked out. Hopefully Bill and Bob are fine too. But there you have it. Still got some work to do with this space shuttle, but I decided to attempt this recording, and of course... Oh. Okay, that's a bit weird. And of course... Okay, this sound is weird. Oh, I can't revert flight. I mean, I don't want to revert flight. I want to go to Space Center. Oh, time warp. No? Okay, as long as it stops making that funny sound, stop that. Okay, so yeah, but once I start recording, I put it up on YouTube, so up it goes. Still about a degree of longitude off, and I will continue working on the space shuttle, trying to get the trajectories down to make sure that we can get it down safely to Cape Canaveral, and hopefully maybe do something with it, but for now, I still got a lot of practice to do. I hope you enjoyed this episode, though. It's an interesting It's an interesting vehicle. It's a very difficult vehicle to put together and make sure it works out all right, especially with Real Solar System and Realism Overhaul and all the deadly reentry and everything. Though, of course, I relied heavily on the reaction wheel from B9, so I have to say that. Alright, anyway, so thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did enjoy the video, please do press like. If you have any comments, suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.